In Zambia, we work on the upper north, where we've got quite a lot of water. So there we work with fish farmers, and it's based on pond aquaculture. So these farmers, they construct their ponds, and we call them ethane ponds. So as you can see here, we've got a depiction of the two different kind of ponds, because Zambia was last year hit with drought. And so even in aquaculture, we are training our farmers to be resilient in the times of drought. So when you look at that pond, that side, that's a typical pond of what the farmers were constructing before we gave them training as GIZ. So we can see from there that those ponds, they look shallower. And when you compare it to this, so after we train them, that they need to deepen their ponds. If they are to be resilient to drought in fish farming, they need to deepen their ponds so that the pond can hold a lot of water, even as much as there's evaporation, but still have some water which will be able to keep some fish there. So that's what you are seeing. And here also, when you look at that model, it doesn't have the pipes there. So the idea is that this water, it's getting out cold water from the ground, going out so that we keep warm water. Because the fish here in Zambia is a tropical region, and our fish thrives well in warmer waters. So those are some of the concepts that we've been training our farmers. And then also when you look down there, we are able to see a depiction of those are vegetables. So we are talking about integrated fish farming. So there's integrated fish, crop and livestock farming. So in times of drought, when a farmer maybe loses on fish, they'll be able to also have some income from the vegetables as well. So the water, the fertilized water that comes from the pond, goes to fertilize the vegetables there. So a farmer spends money to fertilize the pond, and then that fertilized water is being used on the vegetables. So
are you going to you fertilize the pond, means you feed the fish?
No.
Or do you fertilize the pond?
Yeah, so we fertilize it. So we use animal manure, like chicken manure. We also have goat, pigs manure. We put in the pond there. So the water turns green. So when it turns green, it enhances the growth of what we call phytoplanktons, which is food for the fish. Mm-hmm. Yes. So once we harvest the fish, that water still remains very rich in manure. So we just don't want to waste it. So it goes on to the vegetables so that the vegetables can also benefit from the nitrogen that is there.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, so what are these different?
So these are different kinds of feed for fish. Yeah, so we've also trained our small-scale farmers on how they can formulate their own feed from locally grown materials. So they grow crops like maize, they grow soya beans, they grow sunflower. So from that, we teach them to make their own feed. So as you can see, these are in pellets. So even our farmers have got, they use the simple mince machines. That's the same mince they use for beef. So they use this once they mix the different ingredients, maize, cassava, sunflower cake, and then they put it in the mince, and we have the pellets as depicted here. So this also is trying to help our farmers to be resilient during this drought period, that they can also formulate their feed. And also one thing is that in aquaculture, feed is one of the most challenging things because it's expensive. So our farmers find it difficult to buy commercial feed. Mm. So hence we just tell them that they can formulate from their locally grown material so that at least they can, yeah.
Yeah, so this is after the mincing, that's
yes.
Going to be and the
pellets.
Then mm-hmm. You're going to dry it in the sun probably?
Yes, yeah. Yes. So usually in
and
the...
Do they have plastic? I mean, I would assume that mm-hmm. pests are a bit of a problem if you want to store that.
Exactly. Yeah. So once they formulate the feed, you dry it, not really under the sun, but in a shady area so that we don't lose the nutrients as well. Mm-hmm. So once it's dry, they have now to package them whether in sacks or in smaller plastic so that we also avoid the infestation of the pests as well. Yeah.
So how long can they keep the feed then?
So usually we advise them to formulate enough, maybe for, let's say, maybe 3 months to 6 months, because since they have these ingredients, so they can formulate also maybe after 6 months, they formulate some more. So depending on the sizes of the fish ponds that they have, because we also calculate based on the size of the fish pond and also the number of fish that we have stocked in that, then it will give you an idea of how many kgs are required for that fish per day, and it will translate to per month how many kgs do you need, and also at the end of the growing season, which is usually from 6 to 8 months for our farmers. So as a project, we've worked with over 1,700 fish farmers, which we have trained, and they also have ponds. We also incorporate women in these groups so that they can also gain a livelihood from there, because we are also talking about nutrition. So women are key in these trainings. So looking forward, because this project now is phasing out this June. So we have a new project which has come on board, the Sustainable Aquatic Foods. So the Sustainable Aquatic Food Project is building on the knowledge that we've gained from this project, so that we also teach our farmers on how they can enhance their production from feed formulation. So we are also doing some trials on the feed formulation using the fermentation method, so that the nutrients in the feed can be more available to the fish. And also we are also incorporating more trainings on climate smart aquaculture for those farmers, because we know now that climate change is with us. So we need now to also build that resilience with farmers. And also in this new project, we want about 30% of the participants should be women, and also involving the youth. So that's what we are building on. So we don't want to start from the scratch as a new project, but build on what has already worked with the Fish for Food Security project.
And in terms of the farmers, are they usually already fish farmers,
or yes.
Yeah, so your outreach is more to for improvement, not for trying,
yes,
to get more,
exactly,
people to start on that.
Mm-hmm.
So they have their ponds already.
Yes.
You just want them to deepen them, for example.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So what kind of fish are those?
Okay, so for Zambia, we've got different kinds of tilapia. So there are different breams. So we've got what we call the green head bream. We've got the red breasted bream, the three spotted bream. So those are the most common ones.
So in terms of food security,
yes,
wouldn't it be better to have more variety in the fish? Because of, you know, they might, mm-hmm, be all killed by one, I don't know.
Yeah, so as I... Sure. So as I mentioned, like for this indigenous species, so the ones I mentioned are the most common ones, and usually like for these ones, they are resistant to diseases. So like for the time immemorial, it's been rare that we hear that they have these fish diseases. So we usually also encourage them. So we also have the carriers type of fish. So that one is also more resistant to drought. That's, we call it the catfish. And usually it is usually found in the mud. Mm-hmm. So we encourage them that they do what they practice what we call polyculture. So we have the bream and also this catfish in the same pond. So if we go to extreme where maybe the water reduces, we start losing the breams, the carriers usually is tolerant to those. So at least people also have access to that kind of fish species.
Do people buy catfish? Or well, is there resistance to it? I mean, they're not really the best tasting.
Yeah, so I know Zambia is a Christian country, and we've got kind of religion. People don't eat the catfish because it doesn't have scales. Yeah, so we have sections where people don't accept that. But we also have people who accept that kind of fish. So those ones, they easily have access to that. And also what we also encourage these farmers, we've also done cooking demonstrations where we've incorporated fish recipes in that. So also the issue of value addition, we are teaching them how they can also smoke, dry their fish so that in times, in lean months, they can also have access to dry fish. Yeah, so those are some of the ways we're trying to ensure that they can have access to fish throughout the year.
Where do you think this could lead, if you have a bit of a vision where it could lead? And maybe one piece of advice to policymakers in your government departments or in GIZ or to the world, I don't know.
Yeah, so from the lessons learned throughout this project, we've seen that small-scale farmers actually have got the potential, high potential to feed the entire country, because when we look at the statistics, most of the fish usually comes from the small-scale fish farmers. So we really need to put more effort in capacity building through aquaculture for the small-scale farmers, because we know that they've got that high potential to feed the entire nation. And also for our policymakers, the plea is that even as we look at our policies, we should have deliberate policies which are speaking to farmers on the grassroots, and we should also have incentives trickling down to the farmers on the grassroots so that they have access to finance, which is a problem in fish farming. Also the issue of feed, fingerling. So if we can improve the inputs for these fish farmers, they have access also to finances, then we can enhance their production, and it can also contribute to the increased GDP for our country. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.